We are living in a global world, of course, and the internet is global, naturally. So the question may arise, how can we localize our content? How can we localize our Orchid course sites so it's available in multiple languages? Well, English is not accessible to everybody. And even within English, there are local differences that you might want to support. So that's where localization comes into play. And localization is not just about translation. Translating content is one part of it, but various other things need to be localized too. Typically, how numbers and dates are displayed, that also needs localization. There are vast differences in how those are displayed. Orchid supports them. So by default, for example, timestamps are displayed in a localized way, but you still need to configure localization in Orchid. In this tutorial, we won't have a complete overview of localization, but rather I suggest you take a look at the documentation, take a look at the documentation on the localization feature, about the content localization feature, both of which we'll briefly use now, and also our Orchid Dojo blog post and the follow-up blog post here. Because, well, you know, there are a lot of parts to localization. This is more like an introduction to it, or the most important parts. And the most important part is, well, first of all, what do we need to set up in Orchid for it to support multiple cultures to begin with? And secondly, what do you need to do with content to localize it? First of all, we have to go to settings and features again to enable several features. And we will actually need content localization here. Content culture picker is also necessary, but we won't look at that. You can check it out in the documentation. And the base localization feature is a dependency of content localization. So if we enable it, everything will be all right. Now, Orchid has the basic localization infrastructure built in. The localization feature provides support for various configuration on top of that. And content localization also provides support to create localized versions of content items. So where you had one content item before, now you will have multiple versions of that content item for multiple cultures. So all good. Now let's go to settings. And we have, so let's go to settings and cultures. And you see that, well, there is just a single culture defined currently. My machine has a Hungarian culture, so just Hungarian. Let's select the English culture. And, well, let's select, because there are a lot of English culture settings, of course. Let's select the one related to United States. And it's here, and let's edit. Now, in itself, this doesn't change much, but let's save it. What this makes possible is to actually utilize the other culture. Nothing will yet change on the UI. Nothing will change for users yet. This is just to make that culture available. And as you can see, saving this takes a bit of time. As the warning also indicates here, the tenant will be reloaded. For certain settings, this is pretty rare, but still for certain settings, it's not just enough to save something to the database, but rather you also have to reload the whole tenant. All right, so now we have the US culture defined as well. And now we will need to actually start localizing content, because localization is a multi-step process, and here we will only take a look at content localization. which is possibly the most interesting or the one that most people will need to do, because, well, if you have a localized website and the content changes, you will need to use content localization constantly. While the initial setup is fairly just a one-time thing. There are a few such setup steps necessary that we won't take a look at. You need to also install localization packages. So as you can see, the admin UI here now is English. There's actually no Hungarian localization available, so that wouldn't matter either. But if you want to have it in French or German, which are pretty complete localizations, then you need to install the corresponding packages. Also, you need to give users a way to actually change their culture settings. And that front-end content culture picker is one way to do that. You can also display a shape with a culture selector on the front-end. That's a piece of markup on the front-end that will display a selection between the supported cultures. That's documented on Orchard Dojo that I've shown the blog post from. And you have to localize content. So let's look at that one. We had content localization enabled. So now we can go to content types and, well, for example, pages, page, and add localization parts to it, because that will be needed. So let me add the parts called localization. Yes. And how that works is that localization part is not a huge magic, but rather it stores the culture for the current content item. And not just that, but it also allows you to create different versions of the same content item with different cultures. So that way, we have just one page currently, or we will begin with one page, but soon we will have another version of that page. So let's create a new page here. Yep. And what we can do now is that we can add localization part here. So add parts and localization. What this will allow us? It's not a huge magic. Is that localization part will store the culture settings for a given content item. So it will tell what culture that content item corresponds to. And secondly, it will also connect other versions of that content item with other cultures too. And it will help you also create them. So let's see. Let me save the content type definition too, and let's create a new page. And now you see we have these culture settings available here. And by default, it has the default culture. So when I create a new page, it will have the Hungarian culture. So let's create that as Hungarian page. Yeah, nothing else needed here. Publish. And now that it is done, we can actually add an English version of it right here. So let's do that. And as you can see, a new version was created, but it's pre-populated with the data of the original page. Well, in this case, we just have a title, so that's not too useful. And we need a different permalink anyway. But nevertheless, it can be quite useful if you have some kind of involved structure built up with flow parts. All right, so now we have both pages ready. And if you check it out in the admin list, you will see that the culture is also indicated here. And what's more, we can also get to the other version via these little menu items. Now, what we did here is that we created a page with a given culture, and then we added a translation for it with a different culture. the two pages know about each other, they are connected. And that also means that if you set up a content culture picker on the front end as a something that will be displayed where the users can select the culture, then you can, for example, automatically redirect between these pages. If I'm looking at Hungarian page and I select the English culture, then I can be automatically redirected to the English page. And Orchards, of course, still heavily builds on what's built into ASP.NET Core. So localization is the same thing. For example, how the culture for a current request is determined, that is also done by ASP.NET. Well, primarily, you can also override it. So, for example, the current culture settings can come from the URL, they can come from a cookie, or in the case of a content item, the content item will set the current culture too. That I do encourage you to check out more details on the documentation site and on Orchard.io under the blog posts I've linked, because this was just a glimpse of it, but nevertheless, this is an important task that content administrators have to do on a multi-language site.